at this structure. One is trying to understand the divisional structure and its problems. Because why we are talking about divisional performance is because some business entities, there are a lot of businesses. If you look at large businesses, they have divisions. And each of the divisions are set up as individual businesses. Each division will have a CEO. Each division will have its own management structure. So, as a group head, as a common leader, if you're trying to manage entities like this, they have inter-training. They have internal competition. There can be cross-secondary roles like HR, finance that support from a central angle. Shared service centers. So you can cut out and outsource some of the operations. So in this angle, managing a divisional structure is also a skill you need to have for performance management, right? As a from a group angle, group leadership angle. So one area we look at is divisional structure and its problems. In addressing that, the second aspect is this concept of responsibility accounting. After we understand the problems, we look at this concept of responsibility accounting. Thirdly, we approach our technical area, performance, measurement and evaluation. How do you measure and evaluate a division's performance? And finally, interdivisional training. Or what is known as, oh not P5, what is known as transfer pricing. Okay, these are the key areas. Before I get into the technical parts, what can you tell me about the problems related to a divisional structure? You are, imagine you are a company, you have three SBUs. Now, for example, dialogue. Right? Just an example. Mobile, broadband, and dialogue television. These are three divisions, three SBUs. All the three, each of the three has its own leadership, its own management structure, its own way of doing things. Right, sometimes they partner, they work together. Right, DTV agattot, mobile data 20 GB bonus free. Right, game theorem. So there's collaboration. They all sometimes work together. They sometimes compete. Now, for example, mobile and broadband, there's internal competition in terms of data. Right, do you get a customer to use more mobile broadband, SIM-based data, or do you get them to use fixed broadband? These things. Router. What's the give and take? Okay. Who owns the dongle business? Is it a mobile business or is it a fixed business? Oh, there is drama. So imagine you are running the company. If you are running the company, you are looking at the divisions from a helicopter view. What kind of problems does a divisional structure bring you? Yeah, I'll write them down, you tell me.
High cost due to experts in all three SBUs.
So, cost concerns ke ladam, right? For example, there might be duplication of activities. There might be some common activities that are getting duplicated just because of the division of structure. You might be able to remove them and centralize them. Right, so duplication, right, or impact of decentralization. What else?
Yes, goal congruence.
Lack of goal congruence. How?
What does that mean? Lack of goals and goals.
Goal like you know, but pain.
Each contribution is considered about the own objective rather than considered about the main goal of the company.
Clear now? So you're pretty much selfish. You only are worried about your division and you might take decisions that are not very healthy for the overall company. Right? You might be short terms. Maybe you're leaving the company in 2 months. You might make decisions that will help you get the bonus, but company, it's not very good. The decisions you have made, sadly, not very sadly. Right? So, on that note, I can add words like dysfunctional behavior. Dysfunctional behavior is behaving in such a way that you clearly indicate there is a lack of goal congruence, right? Some optimization, different words like that. Anything else? So, did you read the text? Anybody read the text? No, it's like the first part. Oh, there is no, I'm not saying that, like, I'm not, they don't get into a feminist mode. Right? Ade, what can I do? You were there? Huh? You were there? For a book, what have you done? I'll give you a speech. I don't want to. Okay? I can talk about it, but I don't want to. See, if you saw the text, yeah, but tell me, try to think. It's common issues if you're trying to run the business. Yeah.
Concentrating on the short term.
So, short termist decisions. Short termism. So, dysfunctional behavior with short terms. See, short termism is a subset of dysfunctional behavior. There are different kinds of decisions and behaviors. One is you being short terms. If I were to leave the company, I'd make a few decisions that will improve my P&L today, this year. So I'm leaving in 6 months, P&L bonus I'll get. That's a short term is dysfunctional decision. And we talked about short termism last week also, that from overall company perspective. Anything else? Like one very obvious factor. Something very obvious. You guys are not telling me. I'll take it, but in fact this obvious factor is the biggest contributor to that kind of side effects.
Divisional barriers.
How so? Elaborate.
So, like lack of communication between the divisions.
Okay. So, difficulties in communication and coordination. Biggest problem, right? Make a hinda good up prasna. Now I went to watch this movie Kabir Singh. You watch it. A film ne ke entire second half is because of a communication problem. Okay, if that 2 minute gap la, that communication had been done, the film the second half doesn't need to happen. Yeah. Okay, the girl comes, the guy is here, the girl, now the guy gives a deadline. Main thok den tunata kalin aave naththam mama giilla mena kelle ekko badinawane mokkare kiyala yana. I don't want to spoil it. Idipase den kelle enna paya welawata kelle inadi park parak wenawa අර විනාඩි පහ ගැප් එකේ මෝ ડોක්ටර් කෙනෙක් නේ මෝ ප්‍රෙස්ක්‍රිප්ෂන් එකක් ගෙවලා ඒක මෙයා කරලා ඉන්ජෙක්ෂන් එකක් ගහගෙන රැටලා ඉන්නවා. ඒතර කෙල්ල ආවට වැඩක් නැහැ මෝ නැගිටලා. කෙල්ලගේ තාත්තාට ගිහලා මන්දර දීලා මොනවා මොනවාද ප්‍රශ්න. Lack of so that's a very bad example in the context of divisional, but I'm saying that communication is a big issue because you not only got you've got thousands of people, you know, collaborating and trying to work with each other. There can be so many communication gaps. So technology nowadays has eased this problem. You know, WhatsApp group again, conference calls when it come. What we are trying to do is we are trying to utilize technology to address this. Right? එක mail එකක් දැක්කේ නැහැ. ඒක දැක්කේ නැහැ. මේක දැක්කේ නැහැ. ඒක යවුවේ නැහැ. ඒක ආවේ නැහැ. message එක දාන්න බැරි වුණා. meeting එක late වුණා. So many kinds of issues. This is one common issue. Another one I'll add, you have seen if you read the text, controllability. Who is exactly in control of what? You understand? Now, if you are a divisional manager, your bonus is linked to your divisional performance GP margin, your divisional GP margin, or your divisional ROI. Okay? Then, if you don't if the market now boom again, April incident happened, right? Now I'm the head of mobile. Okay, mobile broadband, WhatsApp block, Facebook block, OKO block. Now is data being used as it usually happens in April? No, right? April kiyanne nivadu kaale. Nivadu kaale mon okkoma karanne phone ekige data use karanne vitarai. That entire thing was hit when you block all kinds of social media. Now, is it controllable to me if I'm the head of mobile? But my April P&L is hit, no? Would I like to get penalized because of that? Do I have to get penalized because of that? No, I don't like to. So, I only want you, if you're evaluating my performance, evaluate it based on factors that are within my control. Don't drag things that are out of my control. So, controllability principle, these are key problems. How do we address it? That is where responsibility accounting comes in, especially in terms of focusing on exactly who is responsible for what. When you think about different factors that divisions have within their control, some divisions control only cost. Right. Now, for example, research and development. Research and development, if you think of it as a division, do they have a revenue angle to it? Do they have a revenue angle? Unless you specifically somehow assign revenue from new products or success rate or something like that. Some divisions are particularly related to cost. Some divisions can control both revenue and cost. And others, revenue and cost and investments. Okay. So, depending on the areas that they have control over, we can segregate responsibility centers as these being cost centers, these being what centers? So they have control over top line and bottom line both. Profit centers and investment centers. Because of this difference, guys, actions like performance measurement, performance evaluation, target setting, what I mean is KPIs, okay,
divisional critical success factors? What do you consider as critical success factors for these divisions? Rewarding mechanisms. How do you reward? How do you pay them bonuses, share options? All of these kinds of actions, they vary from each other depending on what kind of responsibility they hold. Right? You don't treat a cost center and an investment center the same way. You don't measure their performance the same way. You don't reward them the same way. They are critical success factors. What they need to really focus on to critically succeed, they're not the same. Right? In fact, the responsibility for an investment center is much higher. You can't say much higher, but the scope is much wider than it is for a cost center. This person can only focus on cost. This is like an all-rounder. This is like a serious batsman. Move batting with bowling with Rakkar. Right? Move batting with bowling. Then I got to run and feel you. Who am I doing? That's the kind of idea here. Right? The scope is wider. So you have to be very careful. In fact, our chapter, this area, we work under the assumption that we are going to learn about evaluating performance of our investment center. Is that clear? Right? This area, we try to look at how do you evaluate performance, measure and evaluate performance of an investment center. So can we, so these two we need to separately look at. This is the overall chapter, how it's structured. Understand that divisional structure has its own problems. And one way to solve that is to look at even managing style. Management style. How you manage these. Now, you don't have different management styles, budget constraint, bureaucratic KI, profit conscious KI, non-accounting. Yeah, different styles. Same style doesn't apply to all three. Different cost centers, different responsibility centers have to be managed in a certain way. Right? So understand that and complete the overview. Transfer goods to B. Right. So B buys, refurbishes, assembles, does whatever it does, and then sells to a finished product is sold. Again, whatever market price that finished product enables. Now, when you are doing internal transfer, the price at which that particular good or service, this price that you transfer internally, any good or service, it could be a service also. You might have skills, expertise, engineers, they're doing outside work, designers, they're doing outside work, but nah, okay. Outside karana nah, actually. Even in that sense, whatever price that you transfer goods at internally, you call this the transfer price. Right? And in such a case, the selling division is called a transferor and the buying division is known as the transferring. Okay?
just illustrate this diagram and write down, or leave some space for the rough idea and the technical words. Next question about transfer pricing is why? Why do we need a transfer pricing policy? Why do we need a system that determines separately the price at which you transfer goods at internally? Why do you need to think about it twice? Well, let's think of it like this. There's a division A, there's a division B. Harad? Division A transfers something at $50. B takes it, sells to external parties, adds another $30. So B spends about 80 and sells at market price 100. Okay? Right? So A sells a component at 50 to B. Right? A can sell this component outside at 60. Right? A can sell it outside at 60, but A is choosing to sell it at to B because B can sell it at 100. Now my question is, regardless of this price, whether it's 50 or 20 or what the price that I transfer, whether it's 5, will this change? Okay, so it's a hit and miss there in what you said. It's a small error in what you said. See, organization point of view, the impact is minimal from a company perspective. The make it part of it. Division only. Transfer pricing is all about these divisions working with each other. Company? No. If A chooses not to transfer and sells outside, company will benefit. Company will benefit. But B will have to get it from somewhere else, no? Ellie. If A is selling outside. Right? There you can have impact. That is a company issue. That has nothing to do with the transfer price. That is a purchasing supplier concern. From whom are we getting it? Am I going to get it internally from A, or am I going to get it from external parties? A will have to make a decision. Should I sell outside or should I transfer internally? Those kind of decisions can affect the company. But in terms of organizational profit, organizational peak performance, the transfer pricing policy can have minimal impact. Unless there is one case, unless your divisions are in different tax regimes. Like Apple, right? They used to, why do they park cash in Ireland? Because it's a significant tax haven. So they established a division there and they pulled in all the money because they get massive tax benefits. So they only take the operational cash they need and distribute it across the world. All the rest of the money comes and stays here. So unless your divisions are in different tax regimes, yes. So ethanin is one reason you can use transfer pricing to manage global tax liability. But that is like the last answer I expect. Shows how advanced your class is. Anything else? Look, when you're doing internal transfer, it's easier. It's easier. You don't have to spend on marketing. Sometimes your company might be in the same premises. Distribution return, you can save. So doing the internal transfer can benefit the buyer. Okay, and it can also benefit the seller, because if you want to push a large volume, it's easier to sell the bulk internally than do a lot of work to try and push it outside. Yeah, but if you're doing internally, there should be a fair price. It can't be too high, it can't be too less. If you're the internal buyer, will you be willing to pay the market price, earlier price, if you're buying internally? It's an option, but you might not be very inclined, you know. Because come on, Atule, me danna danna kattiya kade ubbe division ne kadda bamba. Ema karanne ba. Right? So මට එලියට් ගන්න පුළුවන් මම ඔය ප්‍රයිස් එක පොඩ්ඩක් අඩු කරලා දෙන්න ඕකේ සෝ ඉන් දැට් සෙන්ස් දෙයර් ඉස් අ යූ නීඩ් අ පොලිසි ඔෆ් ට්‍රාන්ස්ෆර් ප්‍රයිසින් ටු ඩිටර්මින් අ ෆෙයර් ප්‍රයිස් when you are doing internal transfers okay it can support the company to drive goal congruence in divisions are we in agreement with that head office can use the transfer price, the fair transfer price, to make sure that the two divisions are in line for the overall company direction. Because end of the day, company profits volatility, is there going to be any impact? No. So the company is very neutral. No? This is about divisional P&Ls. The transfer price will impact each division's profit and loss statement. So you can use the transfer price to manage that. That's one. Okay. Anything else? It can allow room for negotiation. Allow room for internal communications and negotiations. Right? You can even go as far as to say, if you find good collaborative divisions, you can utilize economies of scale. You can scale the company, you can scale the volume that you product, you produce, you can scale up the volume that you are planning to sell, you can collaborate with other divisions and say, look, I'm doing internal transfer. For mechara adala denna marketing patte support ekak deema api company ekata puluwan tarama hoyala denna. Right? I'm willing to put in more hard work for internal transfer because I can push larger volumes. It can help and support utilize more labor. Right? Allow room for negotiation brings me to this. Provide divisional autonomy. For divisional managers. Right? Divisional autonomy. Who is going to negotiate? Who is communicating? Each of the divisional managers, no? Because each division A and B, let's say this is Azman, divisional manager, this is Arman, okay, P&L, my revenue is his cost, no, agreed, okay, so whatever number I decide here will have an impact on my profit, profit A. Whatever number I decide here, negotiate with this profit B. Okay. This discussion is between divisional managers. They will have the freedom, autonomy, to decide, okay, what is the price we are going to do this at. Undenna podiyum wage gahala yanna nan thamai taatha gahala. Again, head office. Meeka karanna ba. Right? So, head office ekka gahala giyama divisional managers la denna inna, CEO inna. CEO කියයි ওই තමුස දෙන්නට බැරි නම් තමුස එළියට විකුණ ගන්නවා තමුස එළියෙන් ගන්නවා බලන්න හරි ට්‍රාන්ස්ෆර් තෝන්නේ මොකොතො ප්‍රශ්න තෝන්නේ but that might not be the best option for the company okay but that's when it goes too far and nothing is happening right so it allows room for divisional autonomy somebody Why a transfer pricing policy? And obviously, guys, record or bookkeeping. Range of transfer price. Can you guys think